Continuing this morning our series in the Gospel of Mark, the cross-shaped life. And last time we looked at what I said was the turning point in Mark, where all of the hints that Jesus had been giving about who he was kind of came to a point. And we get the information straight from Peter's mouth. Jesus is the Messiah, but he is not the Messiah of popular expectation. He's a Messiah of a different kind, a Prince of Peace who, instead of raising his hand when abused and mistreated, takes it. He challenges people to be God's people. Not how we define that, not how popular expectation defines that, but how God himself defines it. And Jesus challenges his disciples in the passage we read last time that his fate, to a lesser or similar extent, will be their fate. They are to pick up their cross and follow him, whatever the cost. And as we probably can imagine, the disciples were a little bit shook up with this news. And we come to the passage in Mark 9, which is right on the heels of what we read last time. So Mark 9, verses 1 to 8. And Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God come with power." After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. And Jesus said, Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. They kept the matter to themselves, discussing what rising from the dead meant. May God bless the reading of his word this morning. You know, it's kind of stating the obvious. You know, I'm going to do my best Captain Obvious impression. People let us down. Sometimes that's an understatement. But I don't want us to focus on that this morning. I'd like us to think of something a little more positive. Can you think of a time when somebody really came through for you? Somebody who just was there at the right moment or did the right thing at the right moment? Maybe they made your day with food or a kind word or maybe even a hug. Has that ever been you? We know in those instances that it's not just the person's kindness that is at work, but it's God working in and through those moments at just the right time. And I want to suggest to you this morning that the story we just read in Mark is like that. It is what the disciples needed at just the right moment. And admittedly, this story is kind of weird. Okay, we're used to Jesus doing some incredible things. He's healed people, we've heard. He's cast out demons. He's calmed the elements. He's taught like nobody else has ever taught. Yet, this is even in light of all of those things, this is a wee bit strange, is it not? Some scholars have even suggested that this is a and I quote, misplaced resurrection story. Like the gospel writers didn't quite get it right, and they just, well, what do we do with this? We'll plunk it in here. Should be at the other end of the story. I disagree. This story captures perfectly Jesus' pastoral heart. We see Jesus care for his disciples after he has robustly challenged them and shook them up. It's a little bit more than that, though, and I just want to touch on this first. Look at verse 38 of chapter 8. It says that if anyone is Jesus speaking to the disciples, the tail end of his little talk with them that we read 2 weeks ago, if anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. That's a pretty bold thing to say. You know, one day I'm coming with my Father's glory with an angelic entourage. That's bold. Doesn't get any bolder than that. And so we could think of the transfiguration as just kind of a proof. Okay, this is Jesus backing up what he just said. And to think of it only in those terms would be tragic. It's not less than that, but it's a lot more than that. Jesus challenging and upsetting words about his death. Remember, he calls Peter Satan because Peter doesn't want him to go to the cross. That's not what the Messiah is supposed to do. And what happens on the mountain ultimately is comforting and reassuring, even if in the moment it's a bit terrifying. So 6 days later, after Jesus has just shook the boat, Peter, James, and John, the big three, the core, the leaders of the disciples, Jesus takes them up a mountain. Not really sure exactly what mountain it was. Mount Tabor or Mount Hermon, probably, one of the two. And it seems as though Jesus' dry cleaners used a wee bit too much Javex. And his clothes are gleaming white. And again, this is not just some kind of pyrotechnics special effects show. You read through the Old Testament, and when God is talked about, in a very powerful scene, he's described as being white, and white symbolizes purity and holiness. And think about the 6 days for a minute. I'm going to come back to that in just a second, but way back in Exodus chapter 24, Moses, after 6 days, is called up to go on the mountain to receive the law. Let's not miss this. Jesus is calling his disciples up another mountain for an encounter, not just with Moses, but with God. The scene has been set. And having, if I can call them this, Mo and Eli with Jesus on the mountain, it's this further proof, an endorsement of Jesus and what he's doing and who he is. And another thing that's really kind of neat about this, in the law, testimony had to be established by two witnesses. Jesus is being endorsed. And, you know, if we didn't grasp it already, God himself says, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." This is reaffirming Jesus' commissioning at his baptism. And so we have this table set. What on earth do we do with it? What do we do with this? Well, first of all, it's encouragement for discipleship and mission. I think we all at times in our life have felt overwhelmed. I appreciated so much at Thanksgiving when people shared how they felt overwhelmed, and in those moments, God spoke to them. This is exactly what is going on in the Transfiguration. Jesus is giving his disciples what they need. He's giving them reassurance. And it's so easy in the course of life to just forget that God is God, to forget that we serve a risen Lord, to forget that the God of the Transfiguration, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, can't be put and won't be put in a box. So I challenge all of us this morning, whatever we're going through, to look to this passage as God's encouragement to you and to me. He is powerful beyond all comprehension. He will give us what we need when we need it. It doesn't mean that our circumstances change, but God gives us what we need and the encouragement to get through those circumstances and to do them with his help. And I'd be remiss if I missed out on something like this, but last week, Stephen challenged us to be the church God has called us to be. Not to sit around and whine about the way things used to be, and, well, we can't do that or this or the other thing because we just can't. And if we think about those things, if we think about what God wants us to do, it's very easy to be overwhelmed. It's very easy, as the people on Thanksgiving shared, we look around our world, and it's downright depressing sometimes. We're not sure what to do. What difference can we make when there are things like ISIS, and there's things like abuse, and there's things like fill in the blank? But this passage challenges us. God has given us a lofty and difficult calling, but he will help us to do it. His power is made perfect in weakness, as Paul says, and we get a glimpse of his power in our passage this morning. And it's a reminder, Stephen last week challenged us to not just kind of frenetically jump into things, but to pray and wait for God's guidance. I think our passage this morning is a reminder of who we are praying to. God has poured out the Holy Spirit, and we can't keep a lid on him. It just won't work. This is comforting. And while we pray, while we wait on God, we need to remember that he's called us to act. The passage ends, "Listen to my son," God says. And here's a challenge within a challenge. How many of you have ever been to a retreat? And it's just been, if I can use this phrase, a mountaintop experience. You've had an encounter with God. You've enjoyed the just meeting with other Christians. God has spoken to you, and you feel energized and encouraged. But the temptation, and I think we all have wrestled with this at one point or another, is to want to hang on to that and not kind of face reality or get back to the grind of picking up our cross. And it might be kind of like the day after Christmas syndrome. We feel a little let down. We feel a little, well, I just want to stay on the mountain. And I think in part that's what's going on with Peter. Peter wants to build three shelters, one for Jesus, one for Mo, and one for Eli. And I think in part, that's him just wanting to preserve this experience. He wants to stay there. But as soon as this scene is over, what do? They walk down the mountain and they get back on the horse of ministry. No, I also think it's a little bit funny. Peter, and Mark tells us as such, Peter didn't know what was going on. I said to Suzanne earlier this week, and Amelia, it's almost like he was saying, well, do you want me to make you some coffee? I'll make you a tent. You know, he's confused. He's overwhelmed, and rightly so. When we encounter who God is, it should overwhelm us. But the incredible thing is that the uncreated one, as we sang this morning, the God of the Transfiguration wants to work through us. He wants us to be his hands and feet in our city. May we respond. May we respond. May we not put off picking up our cross because we just we want to stay on the mountain. It's a challenge, and I want to challenge a few of us met this week, and I want to extend the challenge that we challenged ourselves with to all of you. In light of what we heard last week, in light of our passage this morning, will we pray to the God of the Transfiguration, the God who is powerful beyond all measure, that he would give us our marching orders, that he would give us our mission? Because we have the greatest message ever, the gospel, that God cares about the people of this world more than we can even comprehend, that the things that we go through, our hurts, and the biggest hurt of all, the problem that we have with what the Bible calls sin, our selfishness, that the God of the universe wants to take that burden from each and every person of this world. May we pray that we would find the ways that God wants us to express that message, that we would be in sync with his will for our lives individually, but our collective life as a church here in Halifax. And I also want to say, if you are here this morning, you've never accepted this wonderful gift. Our passage says to listen to Jesus. And one of the things that Jesus says, not in Mark, but in Matthew, Jesus said, come to me all who are weary and heavy burden, and I will give you rest. My yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now, I don't know about you, and I'm pretty sure I've said this before, I don't know about you, but I read those words sometimes and I chuckle to myself, yeah, right, Jesus, your burden's easy. You've just told people to pick up their cross. But folks, compared to the burden of living a life of selfishness and sin, a life of my way or the highway, Jesus' burden is light. And it brings a peace and a forgiveness that is found nowhere else. Thank you, brother. If you're here this morning and God's never taken that burden from you, ask him to. And if you'd like to talk to somebody after the service, by all means, talk to myself. The God of the Transfiguration is ready, willing, and able to help. And all of that is made possible by his death and resurrection, which we will celebrate in just a few minutes. Will we this morning, this week, and in the years to come, will we listen to God's beloved Son? May we do that, and may we experience the reassurance in the same way the disciples were reassured after they were challenged. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for who you are. We are grateful that you care about the details of our lives, and you don't just challenge us and leave us to flounder in our worry, in our insecurity about whether we can live up to your challenge. You care, and you demonstrate who you are. Perhaps it's not as in dramatic a way as we've seen today in our passage, but I believe nonetheless you speak to us. You give us what we need in the moment, and I pray that you would give us individually and as a church what we need. The encouragement, the guidance, and the wisdom to follow you as you've called us to. Please work in the lives of all of us. And may we respond to you as we need to, today and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.